This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have a returning guest. Those of you that are regular listeners to the Thriving Dentist Show know that we do different formats. And one of the formats I like to do is bring guests on board, and we talk about things that we think our listeners would be interested in. And I have a returning guest that was on the show recently, Dr. Paul Etchison. Hey, Paul, welcome back, first of all.
Hey, glad to be back, man. Always good to talk. And every time I get, listeners might not know this, but I feel like every time we do this, we spend at least 30 minutes just catching up before we hit record. So it's good.
True story. we always do a little pre-production catch up, and we have so many things to get caught up with that it ends up being about a 30-minute conversation that I love every minute of it. One of the reasons why I wanted to bring Paul back is that we had so much to talk about on the last episode that we barely nicked the surface. And I thought it'd be good to sort of continue our conversation. Those of you that are regular listeners know that last time we talked about Paul's journey from starting a practice from scratch. And if I remember right, 2012?
Yeah, that's correct.
Starting a practice from scratch in 2012 and developing that practice over time to eventually selling to a DSO in what I think is a fairly short period of time when you look at your start to that transition to a DSO. And I thought it might be useful to continue that conversation and talk more about your thought process. There's a lot of activity today in the dental profession of DSOs acquiring practices. And I imagine that there's many of our listeners that would like to know more about that exercise and more about maybe your own thought process as you went through that process and what your experience was, what things you looked at, what was the good, bad, and ugly of that process. I thought we might just have a fun conversation around that.
Yeah. I think it's unavoidable. I mean, everybody is talking about it because you can't avoid the conversations. So I think it's even for somebody who's not even interested in it, it's still good to know.
Well, I have a wonderful mentor, and many of you have heard me talk about Dr. Omer Reed. Paul, do you remember that name, Dr. Omer Reed? Do you remember?
From you, I remember. I've never met. Yeah.
Just an amazing mentor. We lost Dr. Reed in 2019. He passed at the age of 87, but just such a wonderful mentor. And one of the things he said, because a lot of times he'd get questions from baited questions from the audience. What do you think about this? What do you think about that? And he always said, I love this quote. He said, don't be down on what you're not up on. Don't be down. And that came up very specifically when Dr. Reed, later in his career, he was invited to be a clinical instructor at LVI, the Las Vegas Institute. And one of the areas that LVI kind of had pioneered is the idea of neuromuscular dentistry. And they pioneered kind of a different way of treating occlusion. You know, there's traditional occlusion as taught, as we think of as taught by many people, but I think of Peter Dawson, and I think of, you know, CR, CO, you know, format of treating occlusion. And Bill Dickerson and others used that method, but they also taught neuromuscular dentistry. And there were a lot of people who said, oh, neuromuscular dentistry is a bunch of nonsense, and Omer would say, well, don't be down on what you're not up on. Go peek under the tent, see what it's about, because there may be a patient that this method of treating them may be more effective. Mm-hmm. And I love that approach. Don't be down on what you're not up on. And I think
I'm going to work that in my lexicon. it's going to make its way in.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of dentists that aren't up on, you know, what's going on in the DSO world, and it's kind of easy to shoot arrows, you know, at what we're not up on. And so you have some inside experience from your own journey. I thought our listeners would really benefit from. So start wherever you like, but let's have a conversation around that.
Yeah, I guess I'll start just saying what initially brought me to consider the sale was having a large practice, having a large team. And it, I want to say, like, it was probably maybe the wrong reasons. It was burnout. You know, I was feeling burnout. We went and we shut down for 2020, and I just loved that load off. I just loved taking that load off my shoulders.
Paul, you weren't the only one that found that time, that shutdown time, as actually being a wonderful break from the merry-go-round. You know,
yeah.
It wasn't, we didn't wish it. You know, we wouldn't have wished that on anyone, but there were many dentists that felt like, wow, I get to breathe a little bit. I'm off the merry-go-round. I wish it wasn't under these circumstances, but for the first time in a long time, I have a chance to think about things. I have a chance to think about what the future might be like. I have a chance to think about what I like about my practice, what I don't like. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to make some changes moving forward as we come out of this. And it's sad that it was a forced, you know, a forced shutdown, but I actually think it was restorative for many dentists.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's changed the whole psyche of just, I mean, the culture of everything. I mean, everybody has changed. I mean, just the way they look at stuff and just the way they feel about fulfillment and what they're doing with their life. And
maybe it's the fragility of all of it, you know, Paul, that,
right.
You know, I'd like to think we're all immortal and, you know, we're strong and resilient. And I think in some ways, you know, COVID-19, put a spotlight on the fragility of all of this.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Yeah. So, I mean, we shut down and I would say I had a good leadership structure at my office. We had a large office. I think at the time we shut down, we might've been doing, you know, I mean, we had a big office, multi-doctor, and I don't need to talk numbers, but we had a lot of people. And when I had a leadership structure, I felt like they ran everything. I felt like I did very little. I felt like there was not too much stress with it. And I was manageable. And then when we shut down, when it was gone, I said, oh my gosh, like this is really, to have this gone is so much better. And not to have the practice gone, because, and I'll talk about that a little bit, but just to have that stress gone. I mean, that's what it was. But like right then I was looking, it's the practice. I need to get rid of the practice. So when we came back from COVID, I kind of said, I'm doing things differently. I want that. I want to eat dinner with my family. I want to be done working by 4 o'clock. I want to be able to shut it off. I want to be able to compartmentalize and leave
it's a new
work
day.
At work. Yeah. So right, I want
like,
to do
kind of like it's a new day. What the way I was working before isn't how I want to work, you know, moving forward.
Absolutely.
You know, Paul, I had a very personal experience with that myself in my work, you know, for many years, you know, I was the proverbial road warrior.
Right,
I'd leave on an early morning flight on Monday morning. I called it O Dark 30 because that's what it was.
Yeah.
I'd leave O Dark 30. I'd fly somewhere in the country. I would visit clients. I'd fly around, you know, in the area where I was during the week. And I might come home Friday night if I wasn't speaking at a conference on Friday. If I was speaking at a conference on Saturday, then I'd have to extend that and I'd be out on the road. You know, I left on Monday. It's now Saturday. I might not be able to get home Saturday night because the airlines have fewer flights on Saturday night. Mm-hmm. If I could, I'd get home Saturday night. If not, I'd get home on Sunday and start it all over again on Monday. And I did that for 40 years. And COVID for me had me look at it, you know, inside and say, what do I want to change? What do I want to do differently that would enhance quality of life, allow me to still serve my clients and do what I love, but also improve quality of life. I'm kind of hearing you say the same thing. You still love doing dentistry, love taking care of patients, but you also want to be home for dinner.
Well, and it's true. Like I was working with a life coach at the time. And if anyone's saying, well, what is a life coach and why do you need a coach for life? I think you don't be down on what you're not up on.
There you go.
Right. There we go.
You found a perfect application already.
Yeah. I remember she asked me, she said, when you're at work, and because I said I was going to come back with a different attitude and I was going to do things differently. Now, when we reopened up, there was all these protocols and we had to just go through that period before. And I think it was maybe 6 to 8 months before we were getting back to business. But when we got back to like normal and routine and it felt like it was going again, she asked me, she said, out of your week, you know, Monday through Friday, you know, just don't take the weekends out of it, but out of your week, how much time is spent doing things that bring you joy and how much like, what percentage is bringing you joy? And I said, gosh, it's probably got to be maybe 20-30%. And she said, that's a really sad number. We got to do something about that. And then we started focusing on what bring me joy and what's not bringing me joy. And one of the things was, it was the practice stress. You know, it was this, because I really care about my team. I really care about my practice. And I really care about how things are running. And as you grow a big team, it becomes very difficult to have everyone be happy like it is, or at least like my experience was when I had a smaller team. And I would take that very personally. So I started looking at financials. I started saying, okay, well, I got this really big practice, you know, big numbers, some DSO could probably pay something decent for it. What do I have in the bank? What do I have invested? And what I found was that I could get to my number that was this always this elusive number that one day I was going to hit if I sold my practice.
You know, Paul, the larger your practice gets, the smaller, in the conventional way of selling a practice, the conventional way that's been age old, you know, in dentistry is you find a broker and the practice gets sold to another dentist, as your successor, you know.
Yeah.
That's the conventional way of doing it. And the larger your practice gets, the smaller the universe of potential buyers are.
Yeah. And so there was no way to sell it.
Yeah. And you look at it and you think, well, this is something, well, I've developed something very useful, very valuable. And yet the universe of buyers, it gets smaller and smaller and smaller to the point where there aren't any on that. Yeah. Now, I also want to say, and this is my opinion, I'd love your perspective on it too. Well, I think the way dental offices have been traditionally valued, when you look at valuation, traditionally in the traditional sales model, find a broker, sell your practice, sell it to another dentist as a job. I think the valuation has never really reflected the actual value of the practice. I think they've been undervalued. Mm-hmm. At the time we're recording this, Paul, and I have to put the date on it because it'll change over time. But at the time we're recording this, depending on where you are in the country, if you sell your practice the traditional way, it's typically worth, again, I'm assuming you have some up-to-date equipment and that sort of thing. It's typically worth about 90% of your average annual collections averaged over the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. Would that match up your awareness of traditional valuation method?
Yeah, I'd say that's accurate.
Yeah,
I'd
maybe it's between
it's 70 to 90. Yeah.
And I might even say 80 to 100, depending on if you're in a favorable area, it might be as high as 100%. Very desirable area with the right, the right case mix in your practice, the right systems, the right team, and so on. But I think about that and I think, I would think that business would be worth more than that. You know, when you look at how other businesses are valued.
Well, when we look at real estate,
look at
an apartment building that's, you know, a 5% annual return, you know, they would, you call this a 5 cap, that would sell at a 20x multiple of the revenue or of the profit.
A completely different way of looking at the value of that business.
Yeah.
And really that's what DSOs have brought to the equation is they brought a different valuation model in it. And, you know, the ADA shares, this is a sad statistic. So don't shoot the messenger. This comes from the ADA. The most recent data I have comes from 2019. But in 2019, the ADA said only 3% of dentists age 65 can retire without reducing their lifestyle.
Yeah.
Now that makes me sad.
Right.
Well, dentists, you guys deserve more than this. For, you know, I look at the commitment you've made, you know, to your career, to your patients, to your team, to your community, you deserve better than that. Now, granted, there is that may not be the best definition. So without reducing their lifestyle, well, where's their lifestyle? You know, so maybe there's errors in that. But I think dentists deserve to retire with dignity. And if you're only going to get, you know, 1 year, you know, 90% or 1 year's worth of your production or practice, that doesn't strike me as really being the true value of something you've given heart and soul to for all these years.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's true. And that's why I love what DSOs have brought to it. They're looking at it as a asset, you know,
right,
which it is. It is an asset that generates revenue. And, you know, we're in it for the right reasons. We want to help our patients be healthy. We want to provide a good experience And I mean, one of our mottos and one of our missions is that we want to change what people perceive as like going to the dentist feels like. That's what we've always used as our core value. Right. And, but it is, something that generates revenue. And I think that's what they're realizing. And I think we're in the second wave, you know, of this DSO thing, because everyone thought, well, you just put these practices together. You put them together and you turn around and you sell them to some private equity group and they're going to say, oh, and you get this big multiple and you make this big windfall of cash. And what
that
we've
was,
seen
let's call that DSO 1.0.
Yeah, that's 1.0. And what we've seen in this past year, and especially with like the interest rates and just kind of the climate, is that there are groups, and I'll explain this for listeners, is that you package these up. And they do a recapitalization where they sell their assets and debt to a new buyer who is going to buy a portion of that equity. And then they're also going to help finance future acquisitions. But they have found that some of these companies have went to market and nobody wants to buy them because the numbers aren't good. Because you can't grow a solid business based on just acquiring practices.
Well, let's come back to something you're familiar with, which is real estate. Mm-hmm. There has been time in the, say, commercial real estate. Let's talk about multi-units, apartments. Yeah. There's been times where just buy anything. It doesn't matter. Just buy any, you know, buy 4 units, 6 units, 8 units. It doesn't matter. A good neighborhood, middle-class neighborhood, it doesn't matter.
Right.
Is that an accurate statement? There are periods of time where it almost didn't matter. But over time, it gets more important to evaluate the asset deeper than that. And you have to look under a magnifying glass and make sure that what you're buying meets certain qualities that you're looking for. And maybe that's where we are now in, you know, DSOs 2.0.
That's where I think we are.
Initially, what would you say the time period is of, you know, from DSOs kind of coming on the scene when just putting practices together, anything could kind of work? What would you put the time horizon on that?
You know, I'm not really, you know, it was never on my radar until about 3 years ago.
Okay.
You know, when I did this, so I would say that my idea of this big exit was like to one day I'm going to own multiple practices, maybe, and I'll get maybe 3-4 together. I'll sell them for a 12x multiple, and then I'll ride off into the sunset. And then,
so the guy that isn't getting home for dinner thinks it's a good idea to have 4 or 5 practices.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. No kidding.
Wait, did my sarcasm come out there?
Yeah, I got it a little bit.
what about that changed your mind?
but I'll just say, like,
can we be honest about this, Paul?
Yeah.
There's nothing easy about managing a practice.
No,
there's nothing easy about it. I mean, it there's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. There's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears in HR, in truly, you know, leading and managing a team. And the larger your practice gets, but I've had some of the same thoughts. If one practice is good, 2 would be really good, right? And then 3 mm-hmm. would be like ecstatic. That would be fantastic, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Or would it?
Right.
Well, I had Mark Costas. Mark's a friend. I had Mark Costas on a number of years ago on the podcast. And I was talking to Mark ahead of time in the pre-production. I said, I think at the time, Mark owned 14 practices. And I said, Mark, I want to talk about the joys of owning, the joys and benefits of owning multiple practices. He said, can we change the title to the pain and aggravation of owning multiple practices? And he wasn't kidding. And we joked about it. And I said, well, let's make it a balanced discussion of, you know, the benefits and, you know, what's the reality downside, you know, as well. But man, there's been times where, you know, it takes every ounce of your energy to manage a practice.
Yeah.
Beyond doing the clinical dentistry, right?
Right. And it's like, I remember I bought my first apartment building. This was a 6-unit and I decided I was going to manage it myself because I wanted to, not that I wanted to manage it myself, but I wanted to know what that was like. I wanted to experience.
You want to have the experience.
Yeah. And I remember just every time my phone would ding, I would say, oh gosh, is that a tenant? Is there something that the water, did something break?
Toilets clogged.
And yeah, right. Right. And that's how I felt about my practice is that I had to put up these really strict boundaries that I told my team, you know, I was on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday schedule. I was off Thursday through Sunday. And I told them, I said, do not call me do not bother me. Thursday through Sunday, I'm unavailable. I don't even care if it's burning down. I don't want to know. And I had to put up these very strict boundaries. And what was going on is I would, you know, have all the stress Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And then Thursday through Saturday, Sunday, I just forget about it. And that was, it's a bad way to live. Like, you want to combine your work and your life and your passion. And I don't think I was really gripping that. And when we shut down, it was very apparent to me that something needed to change.
That was sort of the opportunity to really see some things objectively.
Yes, absolutely. So it was, so I went back and I said, what can we get? So I started talking to different groups, and there's all sorts of groups, and there's ones, and I think DSOs get a really bad rap, and I think deservedly so. Certain ones should. And I think there's some really
Be some listeners. Yeah. And I want to diffuse it here. There may be some listeners that think that DSOs are the devil incarnate. I would like to share my perspective on this. And Paul, I'd be interested in yours. My perspective is, let's look at private practice dentists. Among private practice dentists, there's some really, really good ones. Yeah. And there's some okay ones. And there's some not so much.
Right.
Among DSOs, is it possible that that same comparison could be made? There's some good DSOs, there's some okay ones, and there's some we should run away from. Is that a fair, very broad analysis? Is that fair?
I think that's absolutely fair. And I think it's, we see on Facebook forums often that it all gets lumped into one category, which is unfair, but it's this is what how people feel. And that's okay. They can feel like that. But it's this was something that was important to me. Now, I came from my associateship before I opened my practice, a very busy, larger office, a lot of managed care, a lot of HMOs. So we ran like crazy. And one of the things that made me open my office is I just wanted to have a different culture, a different level of management.
You saw another way in that you didn't especially enjoy, and you wanted to do something different.
Yeah. And there was this part of me that said, I'm letting my team down by doing this, and I can't do this to them. I cannot change the practice like this. I can't have somebody coming in here telling us what to do and making it all, like, you know, quote, corporate. Yeah. So that was a big deal for me looking for someone to buy my practice. And I talked to, I'll just share, like, cause people are going to be wondering, but I ended up partnering with MB2, but I talked with a lot of different DSOs, and I'm not going to mention anybody else, but there are some that were very, the deals were very, hey, look at this big multiple we're going to give you, but it's going to come later. It's going to be on the back end if you reach this, this, and this EBITDA goals. If you reach this, if you do the jump through these hoops. And there was
rolling the dice, hoping something was going to happen in the future.
Yes.
Without names, how many did you take a look at in terms of, you know, actually looking under the tent at DSO?
Right. So I had a broker, you know, the deal that I did with my actual deal, that was without a broker, because that was the first company I reached out to. Okay. So that one broker didn't get that. That was in our contract.
Right.
But broker shot me to maybe 30. And I want to say I talked on the phone with 9, and I got pretty far in negotiations with 3.
Okay. Cool. That's actually, I think, would be very useful information for our listeners. I would say pretty thorough, man. You didn't just, you didn't marry the first DSO you dated.
Well, I wanted to, but I felt like it would have been like, I had to do more research, you know. Yeah. I was like, I have to find out what else is out there. But it's interesting because a lot of them, it was like, hey, we're just going to give you stock in the company. That's all we're going to give you. And then you're rolling your dice. You're saying, I don't even know what this company does. I don't even know what kind of structure you have. So that seems a little dangerous to me. And then there's other ones where they came off as, once we get your practice and you start doing things our way, when we get in there and we put our systems in there and train you, man, watch your practice grow. And my practice was doing great. I didn't need systems. I didn't want anyone to come in and tell me what to do. And I do not want a manager. I think I was a crappy associate. I don't work well with managers. I like to do things my way. I don't know if that makes me sound not emotionally intelligent, but I can say that enough that I know that I like things the way I want to do them. And I would not be do well in a practice like that. And I just don't think I could have did that to my team. So what was big for
Paul, I know you and I have known each other for a long time. I know one of the absolutes for you is the quality of care, how you're taking care of your patients. You're not going to compromise that. You want to take care of my perspective is you provide the care to your patients that you would like provided to you or a loved one. Is that accurate?
Yeah.
That's my perception.
And I would say, yeah, 100%.
That may not fly with some, you know, bean counters, you know, in terms of
quotas. I didn't want quotas. I didn't want like production goals. I didn't want any of that stuff.
Yeah.
I wanted to run my practice. And even though, like, I will tell you, so this is coming up, we're recording this in December of 23. 3 days ago was my last day of my contract. So if I wanted to walk away from my practice at this point, I could.
How long were you obligated to stay on board?
I was 3 years. Yeah.
3 years.
Which I think very common is 5 right now. And that was something that I negotiated. And it was funny because they were like, well, why you want to shorten this? What are you trying to do? You trying to get out of here? I'm like, right. No. But I was trying to get out. I want, you know, but over the course of the past 3 years, in what I've realized is that it allowed me to step back because there wasn't so much financial in the practice. I mean, this took a mindset shift to me being like, hey, this should not be as taxing and as important to you because you don't have as much financial on it. And so I backed away and I let my team step up and fill that void a little bit more. And then as they filled it, I became more engaged and got right back into it. But it was for different reasons. It was for because I wanted to be there and I realized how much I loved being part of that team.
A little bit of a turnabout.
Very much. Yeah, very much an epiphany. And people say, well, wow, looking back, do you wish that you would have kept your practice and had this? And I say, absolutely not. I'm so happy that I sold it. And I still own a minority percentage, but it's like I own enough to keep me there to be happy. I'm not doing a ton of clinical. I'm doing about 30 hours a month. So it's like six 5.5-hour days, sometimes 5.5, sometimes 5. And so
that's per month.
Yes, that's per month. Yeah. So it's, and sometimes it's less. Like sometimes I'll take 2 weeks off. I take a lot of time off, but I'm there because
five and a half hour days per week, that's different.
Yeah. That probably wouldn't be too bad either, about 6 days still. But you know, I know I want to be there now, and it's a different way of going there. And I don't think keeping my practice would ever got me there. I don't think I would have been able to make that mindset shift. Now, everything I have now with my quality of life with the practice, I could have had. There's nothing that the DSO is specifically providing that has been life-changing for me. And I will say there are DSOs that are very involved. I have a DSO that's involved as much as I want them to be. And I have a regional manager and she's great, but I every time she says, let me do something for you, I feel like I do nothing. I say, we're totally cool. We're fine. We got it, you know, because I want that. And then that's a big part of the group that I'm in. And that's what's important to me. And I'd say my team, if there wasn't another name that shows up on their check in the bank accounts, I think half of them wouldn't even have noticed. You know, and we didn't lose a lot of people during the transition. We lost some people this past year because of labor stuff. But okay. I'm hearing you say that
it was kind of a more of a hands-off approach from the DSO.
Yeah, like silent DSOs, like the
more of a silent side. One of the fears I think a lot of dentists have is that there'll be forced changes clinically. You know, forcing you to do something that doesn't align with you clinically. What was your experience there?
Well, my experience there is that they do incentivize you because you get a lot of savings if you use certain labs or use certain suppliers. And that's been something that's come up for a few times for me is like, hey, have you ever tried any of these labs? And I'm like, I just really like my labs. And I look at the savings and I look and I go, maybe I should. And I'm just like so stuck in my ways. So there hasn't been nothing.
Leave you alone. In other words, they'll leave you alone.
Yes. Yes, zero. There is nothing. Nobody's.
But you're incentivized to take a look. Like maybe again on economy of scale.
Yeah.
Because they're dealing with many practices, they can say
there's a lot of savings.
We can offer this, but it's not forced. As I'm hearing you say, it's
no, none of it's forced. I mean, like I would say, like supply stuff, we switched a lot of it because it was very significant.
Well, if it's a commodity, if it's a commodity,
exactly, commodity.
Right, but I don't necessarily think of labs as a commodity. I don't think of them as
not to me.
Not at all.
I know my techs and I know who's doing the work and I like it that way. And
but if you can save some bucks on a box of gloves.
Oh yeah.
A little different story.
Yeah. That's a good one. Yeah. So like, I would say like anyone thinking about it, like what we said is just, you can get out there and you can find it out. I don't think I'm not sure if it's for everybody. I think like MB2 is a group that's more targeted towards larger practices, associate driven practices. They do mm-hmm. some solo docs, but they're cherry picking some of the higher producing ones that are going to have growth. And, you know, the benefit is that you get to invest in this company that's going to grow, and you can now get these multiples for your sale that you wouldn't be able to get unless you had multiple practices together.
Which kind of goes back to my critique of the traditional valuation method.
Right.
You know, when you take that practice, you sell it, you know, through a broker to a dentist, it's a one-time transaction. There are no recaps. There are no, you know, no multiples down the road. That's what you got. And, you know, one of my passions is helping dentists achieve financial independence. And my definition of financial independence is the day you can go to work because you want to, not because you have to. Yeah. And actually, I can define that economically. The day when you can reproduce your income, your annual income, without working and also without depleting the principal, is the day you have financial independence. So, Paul, if you're making, I'll just pick a round number. If you're making $400,000 a year, the day you have assets that can produce you $400,000 a year without touching those assets, technically you're independent because you have that income coming from somewhere else.
Yeah.
Then you can go to work as you want to, not because you have to.
And that's exactly how it is. It's an interesting paradigm shift. And there's parts of it that were scary. There was parts of it that, because you anticipate that that's going to do something for you personally, emotionally, and you get there and there's nothing, there's no next step. Like, you've gotten there and you're like, gosh, this is all there is. And then you start to get introspective and you figure out, well, what do I like to do? What brings me joy? What is more important to me than the financials? And that was a process that happened over the past 3 years for me, but a very beneficial and eye-opening. I feel like I gained a lot of wisdom over the process of it. And I feel like I'm in the best place I've ever been in my life, you know? And I feel like if I could go back 12 years, I would do things very different when I opened this practice, not with the practice, but with my mindset and mentality and my emotional well-being during that course, I would have done things very differently. And
is it fair to say that, early on, you did not have work-life balance?
None. I don't know. I mean, I'm glad my daughter doesn't remember the first 4 years of her life, because I barely remember it too. Yeah.
And then, you know, even as, you know, if I'm recounting the history right, maybe the experience of COVID also spotlighted that you didn't have, all of a sudden now you've got work-life balance because you're shut down.
Yes.
By the crisis. Mm-hmm. But that was kind of the wake up call that says you got to achieve some work-life balance.
It was. And if you asked me before, I'd tell you I did. But I, knowing what I know now, I don't think I did at all. And it wasn't that I wasn't home a lot, because I was, like I mentioned, I was 3 days a week, but I wasn't, my mind was always there. What's going on at the practice? What do I need to not spend time with my kids, because I got to fix on these issues that are happening. I've got to talk to personnel. I've got to manage. And this was at a time.
So never really out of mind.
No, never. Wake up in the middle of the night and, you know, just say, gosh, what can I worry about now? Let's think about something. Let's worry. Let's go to sleep. Let's worry, because this is going to help me. This is going to help me. I'm going to get something done laying here worrying about all the things and all the, But
I think I just heard a collective sigh from our listeners. Yes, that's probably really true for many. Tell us about the 3 years. So you just completed literally days ago, as we're recording this, just completed your 3-year agreement.
Right.
What was that 3 years like?
I would say this has been the most difficult 3 years of my practice, and not because of the DSO, because of the labor environment and all that, you know, because of the marketplace of personnel. And I think this new consciousness of people coming back from COVID that are just, they want more meaning. And I had a very large practice. We had no turnover. I'm not lying. We had zero for almost 10 years. We had the same team, just kept growing and growing. And
we're in the middle of a massive cultural shift.
Oh, gosh.
In terms of workplace.
Yeah.
And I think it was triggered, by COVID.
Well, I used to talk about this as like, I would speak on this and I would say like, hey, this is how you have a zero turnover office. This is the way you manage. This is the way you lead. These are the principles you come from. This is the, where you have to kind of, where you have to stand and stand for certain things. And I don't know if it was karma or I think it's the cultural shift, but I got my butt kicked these past 2 years bad, you know, with some turnover, and that's nothing to do with the DSO. It's just, we just had this cultural shift, and I think a lot of my team had been there a really long time and was onto something new. But it's just like everything, man. It's like we just lost two team members the other week. They walked out on the same day, and I was hurt. It felt bad. And I talked about this on my podcast, and it really hurt. It's one of those top three for me that if I'm going to remember on my practice career, this one hurt pretty bad. Plus because of the office they went to. But I will tell you, you know, this was 2 weeks ago. We found two fantastic people. So many people were glad that they were gone. So many people were saying, gosh, I just didn't realize what a drain they were. And I didn't realize it either. And every bad thing you go through, if you're willing to put that energy into and like really looking at what is it, what is the learn from this, I think you can always come out on top. And I think that's just how it is. You have to go through that process. It'd be nice to have the answers at the beginning and not have to experience it, but I think you have to work through the experience yourself.
Right. And I imagine there's a certain amount of comfort in knowing that, as my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, but one of the advantages of DSO is that they will typically handle the HR functions, the hiring, the firing, the reviews, the compliance, all of that.
Yes.
And I imagine that you felt some support, even though you didn't appreciate the attrition, but it wasn't your problem. But you had interest in it being resolved in a favorable way. Well, is that a good way to say it?
I would say it was my problem, because like I mentioned, these services are available to me, but I prefer to do them myself. Now, yes, we do utilize their HR as far as like hiring. They will vet people and send us people. But as far as dealing with interpersonal stuff that's going on at the office, we still handle that with me and my leadership team. Now, but the big difference is I have a key player that has stepped up into this role. She likes it and she wanted to do it. And I said, what do you think about just doing it for everybody? And I'll just communicate through you. And she stepped up and she took it. And at the beginning, I saw the burnout in her. I saw her going through the same issues I was. She was going through, I don't know what to do. I'm doing so much and it's just never enough. And I said, this is how it is. And we worked through it. And she had so much personal leadership growth during this period. And she's in a great place right now. And I'm in a great place because I got that off onto her, is that she's managing the office in that regard as far as the HR stuff. But yeah, we have an HR company. We have HR to lean back on, somebody to ask for like labor law stuff when we're getting into hairy situations, and also like making sure the compliance and the onboarding, all that's done. They do all that for
us. Yeah, some support.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, a sale to a DSO can actually be done at any stage in your career. It's not just a late stage. Yeah. A late stage strategy. It could be done. Well, when I say early stage, relatively early stage, you have to have something valuable. So relatively early stage. And it can also be done, mid career, and it can be done later career. Now you've done this, you're a young guy. Well, you've done this relatively young, as opposed to waiting to the finish line. And I would think that, be interesting to, comment on that. And, you're getting work-life balance at a time that, you get to get the benefits of that instead of, someday I'm going to get that.
Well, I still have kids at home too, and I have a 13-year-old and an 8-year-old, and, this just comes back to like working with my life coach. This is one thing. This was the pivotal moment that she said, is she asked me, she said, what happens if what's the worst case scenario? You sell your practice to a DSO. So worst case scenario is I hate it. I don't like the control they have over me. I don't want to be there. I feel bad for my team and I just leave. And she said, do you think you could build another practice? And I said, I could build one exactly the same. I could probably do it in half the time. And she said, so then what's the issue?
What's the risk?
And I said, well, it's the people. It's the people. I like the, she's like, but do you think you might hire new people or even hire some of those old people and bring them on? I said, yeah, you're probably right. And I said, you know what? It's not the end all be all. It's just a new chapter. It's not like it's this big finality that I'll never be able to get back. Now, yes, I'll never be able to have 100% equity in my practice ever again. But if it was only about the equity, I wouldn't still be there. It's about that, what I like about it. And it's about being with the team and being part of something and changing lives. And I think I had to get out of it to get back into it. Like I mentioned, I was on my way out, but I'm still there long term. That could change. I'm 40, or I was 40 when I sold. I'm 42 now, and so when I look forward and I say, okay, what am I doing for the rest of my life? I want to sit at home. I want to do whatever I want. What is that stuff? Sitting around doing nothing is not good for anybody.
No, there's gotta be some purpose. There's gotta be some meaning.
You've got to get out on a bike. You got to plan things. You got to go out of your way to do things, because it's not sitting at home gets really old really fast. And you go through all those shows and you're out of them. There's not much to do. And that's where I realized is that I do need to do something. I do like doing stuff. Now, what's the next chapter of my life for my 40s going to be? I thought it was going to be something different. I didn't know if it was going to be in dentistry or not, but it is for now. And that's cool. And if someday it's not going to be, and I'll find something else to do and I'll work on some other stuff. My wife
something
has
that
a
has
business.
Purpose.
Yeah. I mean, my wife has a business. She does self-empowerment classes for girls ages 8 to 13. I was engaged in that for a little bit. I liked it. Didn't love it. But you can pivot. But my pivots now are based on joy and what it brings to my life rather than financials.
I'll share a bit of my background that I've never shared on the podcast that I haven't shared with you, Paul. But I started my career in dentistry with a wonderful mentor by the name of Rick Mercer. Rick Mercer, mm-hmm. You probably recognize that name. Mm-hmm. Mercer Global Advisors. Yep. Many will recognize that name. Mercer merged and over the time, became Spear Education. In terms of history, but I worked with Rick. He was a wonderful mentor, and all of our clients were physicians and dentists. And I was one of his assistants. I just had such a great experience. But Rick would talk to our doctors, physicians and dentists, and they were always trying to get to the finish line of retirement, get to retirement. Yep. And he would say, "Well, Paul, that's a noble goal, and what will you do when you retire?" And the doctor would say, "Well, I'm gonna play golf." Do you play golf now? "Yeah, I play, but I'm gonna play more golf. I don't get to play enough golf." "Well, and after you're done playing golf, what are you gonna do?" "Well, I'm gonna travel." "Do you travel now?" "Yeah, my wife and I travel a lot, but I want to travel more. There's so many places I want to go." "Well, after you play golf, after you've traveled, what are you gonna do?" And this would continue. "I'm in a garden." "Well, do you garden now?" "Yeah, but I'm going to really garden." And it would go on and on and on. And Rick was really good about continuing this discussion, just sticking with it. And then what? And at some point, every single time, the doctor would say, "It's not going to get any better than what I have right now, is it?"
No,
because right now I've got purpose. I love what I do. I love taking care of my patients. And that was the revelation. He helped them understand that. And then what? And then what? And then what? You're staying. Mary Osborne calls that staying in the question. Rick didn't know that terminology, but that's what he was doing. He was, and then what? And then, I'm just going to relax. Okay. And then what? And I think it helped everyone understand that, and where's the purpose?
Yeah. And I think that's worth talking about, because I was the same way. I rat raced. I wanted to get to the number. And if I could go back and do it, I would say, I don't need to get to that number, because I'm at this number now. And it's the only thing that's different is, I guess, the possibility that I could just switch something that fast. But what I've realized is that in order to have that fulfillment and that happiness, I had all of the tools the whole entire time. I wasn't utilizing them and I wasn't having the right mindset around it. I was thinking I had to get to the number, but it was for me getting the number, getting there, crossing that, and realize, oh gosh, that didn't work. And having to do some really big self-growth that I realized I had it the whole time. I could have had a completely different practice experience. And I'm not saying I was miserable the 12 years I owned my practice. I was not miserable by any means. I mean, there were parts. There were some dark periods, of course. Yes, but... Yeah. But it could have been better. I could have had a better life balance. I could have had more joy at home. I could have relaxed. I needed to relax. And I think that is my inability to relax and inability to sometimes let things go and mentally is probably was one of the things that was the strength in building this practice. So it was a blessing and a curse, but I would go back and do it differently.
I completely agree. The strengths that we have can sometimes be a blessing and a curse. Absolutely. Paul, you're going to continue. Give us the sneak peek into the crystal ball in the future, at least on the near term. What are you doing? You going to continue?
I'm continuing. I'm doing the dentistry I like to do. I do veneers and I do ortho band and bracket on kids. That's what I love to do. Awesome. I just like doing that. And I like going in there and just spending time and brainstorming with the team. We are going through some, I wouldn't say major cultural things right now, but we are reigniting our culture after losing these two people. It has brought us to a point where we said, you know what? We're done tolerating. And if you're not all in, get out. We don't want anyone that's not all in. And it has been such a different feel this past week. And we're so excited to go forward with that. So that's the.
And I actually have a note, as our listeners might not know, but Paul and I are actually on Zoom together and I can see his face right now. And I see you smiling as you're saying that. And I'm hearing not so much as, a debilitating challenge. It's like, and yes. I'm excited about doing this.
I am excited to be doing it. Absolutely. That's the change is knowing that. And I go through this with my coaching clients. I'll tell them personal stories and they say, I can't believe the way your practice runs. You still have issues. Oh man, they never go away.
Yeah.
So you can't get it right. You just got to keep moving. You'll never get it perfectly right. You just got to keep moving and know that you can handle it and that you're always going to get through whatever it is.
As we wrap up today, wisdom would you have for any of our listeners that may be considering looking at a DSO? What message would you like to deliver to them?
Yeah, my message would be track record. I would very much look at that. And I think that became apparent with two very big ones that went to market. And there's a number of smaller ones that went to market that nobody wanted to buy. There are some lawsuits out there where owners were promised all this stuff and they didn't deliver. And the reason they didn't deliver is because it's a little bit more complicated than just buying and bundling and rolling up practices together. So I would say, look at track record. If you're looking at that gut feeling, I would say I had gut feelings with those other ones that I got really far with. And my gut feeling was not good. I have no verification there's no way for me to know how that would have panned out. But I would say that I know a lot of people that have done this, and there are some people that were promised a recap, which that's the liquidity financial event, like within 3 years. And I know some people that are waiting there on year 5 and 6 now. So you don't always get, there's not apples to apples. It's
intuition. Intuition is a very useful element, isn't it?
Yeah. And it is. And I think the other thing is too, is track record is important because, I mean, I guess I'll just give an example without saying actual numbers, is I sold 60% first. And then at the recap, I sold 20%. I took that 20%, I paid taxes on it, and I invested it back in. And that 20% of my practice is now going to be worth more than the 100% valuation from the first sale. So
the way I like to describe that visually is a smaller slice of a bigger pie can be more, it can be worth more than the whole pie.
Yeah. 20% of my practice was probably worth, a lot more than it was worth, more than the whole practice was worth when I started. Yeah. And that's because of getting in those economics and banding together. And so that's the benefit. And that was the other thing to answer your question earlier that you asked, what does this look like for somebody younger in their career? And why would that make sense? Because you can do this as a financial strategy and not an exit strategy. It doesn't have to be an exit strategy.
Great, great point. I think we think of as it's all about the finish line.
Right.
You know, it's all about that fit. And in fact, I love your point there. It can be a financial strategy at any stage of your career and not an exit strategy.
Yeah. And I don't know. I don't want to scare people in that they're going to miss it, but we have no idea how long this is going to last.
Perception on that, yeah. Paul, because I've talked to a lot of DSOs. I'm connected to a lot of DSOs. I'm also connected to the financial side, the private equity side. My perception is the fundamentals on dentistry are so good that I think quality private equity is always going to be interested in dentistry, because where else can they invest in businesses that are recession resistant? I'm not going to say recession proof, but people need dentistry in good times and bad. We've weathered the Great Recession in 2007, 2008, 2009. Yeah, we weathered the pandemic very well. I don't see the fundamentals changing radically. And largely private equity is very conservative. They are not they don't roll the dice. It's not like venture capital where they know if a venture capital firm makes 20 investments, they count on 19 of them absolutely flat out failing. But the one that makes it makes up for the other 19 losses. Private equity is the opposite. They don't want to lose any capital.
They'll hire companies like firms to scout out these investments and to do like private unsolicited calls to members to try to find out more information, like sneaking in and like getting like the dirt and like finding out, is this a good investment? Because they're not messing around. Right. They got to take care of that money.
But dentistry has some fundamental qualities that make it very attractive to the private equity firms. Yeah. And I don't want to say, you know, can just count on it forever, but I don't see that going away. But one point that I would make is quality is very important. So it's not just a matter of rolling up offices and, you know, it's always going to be a big win. Quality is very important. And none of this should change any dentist strategy in terms of day to day, because the goal should be to develop your practice to full potential. When you develop your practice to full potential, whether it's a traditional, you know, strategy of selling to another dentist or it's partnering with the DSO, you've got something that's valuable.
Or if it's just for yourself.
Yeah.
There's no reason not to do it.
The satisfaction of yourself of having that asset that's developed to full potential. I think a lot of that should be built around, you know, patient centric as well, because when you think about the patient and what you can do to improve their lives, that's often a good business result as well. Well, Paul, thank you. Thank you for sharing your insights and sharing the vulnerability of what you've experienced yourself. I appreciate your honesty, your candor. I appreciate, you know, sharing this with our listeners. I believe anybody listening is going to get lots out of our episode today. As we wrap up today, Paul, again, thank you. Thank you for being a great friend. I count you as someone I can reach out to and bounce ideas off. And I hope you feel the same way about myself.
Absolutely.
Love the work that you're doing. And I love the person that you are. And I appreciate our friendship for sure.
Thanks so much, Gary.
I also want to thank all of our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you. If you know of someone that you think might appreciate listening to the Thriving Dentist Show, hey, share it with them. We always make room for more listeners. We'd appreciate your help. On that note, let me simply say thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.